Okay, so this is the first breaking down the documents for the Moscow, Idaho, Brian Kohberger specifically case. A lot of y'all had asked me to do so. I did a video and got a lot of responses that y'all wanted this, so that's what we're going to do. Now, this right here that we're looking at is the first document that was released after the affidavit, which I, since the affidavit's so long, we'll break it down probably in a series of videos on its own. But for this particular video, we're going to break down the probable cause order. So basically, and we're going to do it specifically for Idaho, although in most states, it's going to be fairly similar, right? So after a complaint is presented to a judge, the judge may issue a warrant for the arrest of the defendant only after making a determination that there's probable cause to believe that an offense actually been committed and that the defendant, in this case, Brian Kohberger, is the one who committed it. Now, the finding of probable cause must be based on substantial evidence. So they have to have a decent amount of stuff, which also may be hearsay. Now, hearsay is something that's not necessarily determinable. It could be something as long, like, for example, me telling you or me telling a judge that I saw so-and-so hit a car. Nobody else but me saw that. It can't be verified. So that's hearsay. But in this case, in whole or in part, it's allowed. Provided that there's a substantial basis for it. So considering the totality of the circumstances, everything that's happened, and to believe that that there's enough probable cause to exist for them to issue an arrest warrant, the judge may also rely on information provided in the form of an affidavit, which is what they did in this case, that 19-page affidavit that Moscow police released, or a sworn oral statement. So something that basically they come in, they swear upon it, it's essentially not notarized, but seen before a judge, or could be notarized, but a sworn statement. Okay, so now to break down the document a little bit more, this top part up here, okay, is called the caption, all right? So what this does is it identifies which case the document belongs to and lists the title. So for here, State of Idaho versus Brian C. Kohberger, case number, it's over here. Probable cause order. That's all the caption. Okay. It's a standard form document that's used by the court and allows the findings to be checked off. So you can see the findings, you know, down here where they've checked a couple things. This document is necessary to have an arrest warrant issued under Idaho law. And according to Idaho court rules, a judge may issue an arrest warrant only after they've reviewed the information presented in the probable cause affidavit and determined that there is enough probable cause to believe that an offense has been committed. And as I said earlier, that the defendant, again, Brian Kohberger in this case, committed it. The arrest warrant can only be issued after it's determined that there is substantial evidence. Otherwise, it will not be issued. And that substantial evidence can include evidence that will never even be admissible at trial, such as hearsay, which we talked about earlier. The judge then reviews all the circumstances surrounding the accusations to help them make a determination. That's also why, if we go back and we look here, it says, upon review of the information provided under oath, alleging the defendant committed the offenses of blank. And I mean, in this case, it says burglary, and then there is four murders in the first degree charges here. But because it says upon review for those reasons, because they review the accusations. In this case, it's burglary and murder. Then it specifically lists what the person is being charged with, which is, again, burglary and murder, and what parts of the Idaho criminal code is being violated by the number. So you see the statutes right here for all of them. Now, for the murders, all of them are going to be the same because it's all first-degree murder, and the only one that's different here is the burglary one, a little bit. Okay. Next, the judge is going to check off whether or not they have found probable cause, and that in this case, the judge has found probable cause enough to be able to issue this warrant. So the handwritten notes are to inform police, which you have hand, like you see right here, a warrant of arrest shall be issued setting the bail at the amount of, and she writes no bail and puts, you know, statute codes right there. So the handwritten notes are to inform the police that they cannot independently release him on bail. So police departments, due to whatever the reasons, jail overcrowding or even the severity of the crime or lack thereof in certain cases, can set bail and release people until an arraignment where an actual bail can be set by a judge. And then basically they can be released until that arraignment. And I'm trying to think of how I want to say this. We can release until the arraignment. And then there will be an actual, you know, bail hearing. Bond is typically 10% of the bail amount. In major cases like this one, though, there's language instructing the police that they do not have the right, the authority, the ability to release the person, Brian Kohberger, and must hold him until a court authority, a judge, is available. The document also directs that the court can impose reasonable terms, conditions, and prohibitions of release that the court deems is necessary. And a lot of times they do that for the protection of the public, which in this case, with its severity being four brutal homicides, that would be the case here. So this was our first breakdown of this, a little bit more in depth. I hope that you found it valuable. If so, leave a comment, let me know. And we will start and do a few more of these documents as we go.